Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Buckskin Line by Elmer Kelton. Narrated by George Guidall. Prologue. The Texas Rangers had their beginnings in 1823 when land impresario Stephen F. Austin raised a volunteer company of 10 men to act in defense of his colony in Mexican Texas. Rangers served during the decade of the Texas Republic and rode alongside the United States Army in the war against Mexico. Later in the years before and during the Civil War, volunteers manned a ragged picket line along the western frontier, guarding against Indian incursions. They had no official title, but were commonly called rangers or ranging companies, minutemen, or spies. During Reconstruction, they were disbanded and replaced by a state police force, which did some good work but was badly stained by internal corruption and unwarranted cruelties. When the Confederate Texans finally regained the right to vote, they dissolved the hated state police. The reorganized state legislature created two battalions of Texas Rangers in 1874, giving them for the first time their official name and the famous Star in a Circle badge, which was to become the stuff of legend. This is a story of the early days when small companies of poorly paid, poorly fed volunteers in homespun cloth and buckskin rode an unmarked frontier line for a primitive Texas that had only a toenail hold on survival. They had no uniform, no badge, not even an official name. But they had a job to do, and against all odds, they managed to do it. The story begins with one of the most unlikely events in early Texas history, the great Comanche raid that led to the sacking of Linville down on the shores of the Gulf of Mexico. Part 1. Chapter 1. Texas Gulf Coast, August 1840. He was Comanche, and he was known among the people as Buffalo Caller. Once in a time of hunger, when he was a fledgling on one of his first hunts, the older and more experienced men had ridden their horses to exhaustion without scaring up so much as one lone, lame bull. But Buffalo Caller, riding alone, had heard a faint and distant bellow. He'd responded in the voice of a buffalo, and the buffalo had answered him. The calls led him to a small herd in a hidden canyon. It was not buffalo he hunted now. He scouted as a wolf for the largest assembly of raiders the Penateca band had ever put together, moving to strike the land-greedy, hair-faced American settlers of Texas. Beside him, against the Texans, rode Swift as the Antelope, so named for his fleetness of foot. Buffalo Caller tingled with excitement over the sights he was about to behold. He had never seen an ocean, or even a boat, so it strained his imagination to visualize what old men had described around their campfires. If the veterans had not let fanciful dreams overcome the realities of memory, those wonders lay no more than half a day's horseback journey ahead of him. It was claimed that the great water stretched so far one could not see all the way across. None of the people had ever ventured out upon it to determine how far it extended, for they were of the land, not of the sea. It was said that white men's boats might travel for many days without touching shore, and that fish larger than horses lived in the dark and frightening depths. Buffalo Caller doubted much of what he had heard. It sounded typical of the white Tabo's lies. He had forded many rivers, and he had visited lakes wider than the rivers, but none were so wide that he could not see the opposite side. Where he rode now was far to the south and east of the short grass prairie and the limestone hill hunting grounds he was accustomed to roaming. A journey of many days had brought the massive Comanche war column into a gently rolling land of sandy soil and tall, summer-cured grass, much different from the higher, drier land the Penatecas claimed as home. The hot, humid wind carried a smell foreign to his experience and left a faint suggestion of salt upon his lips. Summer heat sent sweat rolling down from beneath his buffalo horn headdress and into his paint-streaked face, burning his eyes. The foreignness of this land made him uneasy, despite the persistent gnawing of curiosity. Though he wanted to see the great water for himself, He would be relieved when they finished what they came to do so they could return to country more suited to his experience. What they were about was vengeance, blood for blood. In the early spring, many tribal leaders and warriors had met with white chiefs in San Antonio de Bejar's council house to discuss an earlier agreement by the Comanches to free all their captives. Some had reconsidered the promise and balked, holding out for stronger terms. Talk had led to quarrel, and quarrel to the loosing of arrows and an explosion of gunfire. When the smoke drifted away, more than 30 Indians lay dead and dying in the council house and in the foul dirt of San Antonio's narrow streets. In retaliation, the people had killed most of the remaining white captives, but those had not bled enough to wash away the stain of the San Antonio disaster. The indignant Penatecas had undertaken this huge, punitive expedition, carrying them far beyond their normal range, all the way eastward to the Gulf of Mexico. He did not know how many of the people were on this grand adventure. He had attempted to count them on his fingers and thumbs, but the task overwhelmed him. They were so many that they defied his understanding of numbers. Their horses left the grass beaten down and the ground scarred in their wake like the slow passage of a large buffalo herd. Though the object was war, many women and children had come along to watch and cheer as their warriors carried calamity to the white enemy. Mexican allies guided them, for they knew the route. They knew how to pick their way through the sparsely settled region and avoid detection until time for the great force to loose its thunder and lightning. Buffalo Caller understood that the Americans had won this land from the Mexicans in a fierce war. Mexico wanted to take it back, and had sent emissaries to the tribes, promising many good things in return for their aid. Buffalo Caller cared nothing for Mexico, but the first raid in which he had ridden had been against Mexicans. He had fought them often and had killed many. But he welcomed any chance to strike the Texans. A temporary alliance with a former adversary was justifiable if it promised victory over an enemy hated even more. Antelope pulled up on his rawhide reins. "The wind brings a smell of smoke." He raised his head, sniffing, testing. Antelope was notoriously subject to quick judgments and quick action, without considering where they might lead. Buffalo Caller smelled only dust, but the ground was so dry it had cracked open in places. The soil would all be up and moving on the wind were it not bound by a heavy stand of brittle grass, the result of last spring's rains. He drew the skin taut at the edge of his right eye, trying to sharpen his vision. He decided Antelope was right this time. "I think I see a house. It is beyond the timber there." His companion thumped the heels of his moccasins against his mount's ribs, putting him into a trot. "If they have horses, we shall take them." Buffalo Caller feared that Antelope's zeal would make him forget their real mission. "Taking horses is not what you and I have been sent to do." The principal concern so far had been to avoid premature detection as the army of warriors moved along. The wolves were to overtake and kill any whites who might observe their passage before the trap was sprung. That precaution seemed less important now because scouts had reported that the town of Victoria lay only a short distance ahead. The Americans would soon know of the column's coming. One Mexican guide had lived in Victoria until the Texans drove him out and he itched for retribution. Victoria had been chosen as the first target. Buffalo Caller recognized Antelope's determination. He relented, knowing Antelope would do whatever he wanted, regardless of advice to the contrary. "If we find horses, there is no reason they should not be ours." He set his dun horse into a trot that matched Antelope's pace. Antelope grunted. "If we find any tabos, we will take their scalps as well as their horses." His taste for vengeance was strong. A brother's blood had soaked into the floor of the San Antonio Council House. "So long as we do not leave our own." Emerging from a small patch of timber, they saw a man afoot in a cornfield, wielding a curved knife to cut heads from the stalks, tossing them into the bed of a wagon drawn by two horses. His back turned, he did not see the warriors approach. Antelope said, "You take the horses. I will take the man." Not until he heard the hooves did the farmer turn. He wasted a long moment, frozen in startled disbelief, as the two Comanches rushed down upon him. Then he ran for the rail fence, Antelope's arrow struck him in the middle of his back. He fell forward onto his face. The warrior leaped from his horse, vaulted over the low fence, and knelt beside the dying man, slicing a patch of scalp with his knife. Buffalo Caller saw no need for undue haste. He climbed over the fence and cut the two horses loose from the wagon. They were docile, but human beings did to one another concerned them little. Antelope raised the bloody trophy for Buffalo Caller to observe, then looked toward the log cabin. There may be others. Whoever was at the house might have a rifle or shotgun. Buffalo Caller saw none here. This was far from normal Comanche range, and the once formidable Carrancoas native to this region had been reduced to a pitiable scattered few. The farmer probably had seen no reason to burden himself with a weapon in the field. We have the horses. That is what we came for, Antelope insisted. If you leave one wasp, it will rebuild the nest. But if they fire upon us, we must leave. We can do no good for anyone if we are dead. It was not that he feared death. A warrior who died in battle was promised a happy afterlife. But the life he was living here gave him pleasure, for he was yet young, and so were his two wives. He would enjoy this life as long as he could. The next would endure forever, so he was in no hurry to begin it. They approached by way of the barn, larger than the cabin, and built of rough boards instead of logs. His gaze was focused on the house, for if there was to be trouble, it would come from there. Antelope touched his arm and pointed in silence. Beneath a roof that extended beyond the barn, a woman sat on a stool milking a cow. Like the man, she faced away from the Indians and was unaware of them. The two warriors slipped down from their horses and moved toward a log fence that separated them from the barn. Buffalo Caller climbed to the top and swung his legs over. A log cracked beneath his weight. Startled, the woman looked around, saw him, and jumped to her feet, spilling the bucket of milk. With a cry of fear, she ran to the barn door and turned, a pitchfork in her hands. Buffalo Caller had never seen a pitchfork and did not know what use it was meant for, but he recognized that the sharp steel tines could pierce like a lance. She made a threatening gesture, thrusting the fork toward him. She shouted, but her words meant nothing. White people's talk was like the grunting of their stinking pigs. He entertained the thought of taking her along, for his wives would welcome a slave woman to lift some of the labor's weight from their shoulders. Too, he had never taken a table woman into his blankets, and he wondered how different one might be. But she came at him with the pitchfork, and he had no choice. He fitted an arrow to the bowstring and drove it into her heart. She died quickly, with little sound and little struggle. He had noticed from the first that her hair was reddish, like the hair of a buffalo calf. He knelt over her and lifted a strand of it, wondering if she might have colored it somehow, but none of the color came off on his fingers, so he decided it was natural. It would be a great curiosity when he showed it to his friends. He made a wide circle with the keen blade of his knife, wanting to keep as much of the hair as he could. He placed his foot on her back and pulled on the scalp. It tore free with a sucking sound. He heard a movement in the barn and turned quickly, bringing another arrow out of the quiver. He stopped, for in the doorway stood a small boy with hair redder than his mother's. Buffalo Caller could only stare. Antelope spoke from behind him. Are you frightened of a baby? I will kill him for you if you are afraid. I am not afraid, but I have never seen hair of such a color, not on a human being. He recognized that the Americans were humans, though of a lesser order. The Comanches were the real people, the true human beings. Antelope said, The Texans have hair of all colors. He brought out his knife and moved toward the child. Buffalo Caller blocked his path. My wives have given me only girl babies so far. I will take this boy for a son. And carry him into the fight? He will be a burden. But I can teach him to be a good hunter. He could keep us from hunger when we are old. A white-skinned paniteca with hair like fire? Never saw such a thing. The buffalo will not care about the color of his hair. The people had often taken Mexican children and raised them as their own. Captives helped offset the death rate caused by war and by accidents during the hunt. Since Americans had begun moving into Penateca lands, a sprinkling of lighter-skinned children had also appeared in the lodges. Most who survived the trauma of the first weeks would assimilate into the tribe. In time, a majority would forget their past lives and become as Comanche-born.
Antelope argued. We should kill him. The color of his hair is like blood. It could sour our medicine.
What has hair to do with medicine?
The boy looked in bewilderment at his mother's body. He whimpered as Buffalo Caller picked him up and tucked him under his right arm. Antelope said, I cannot tolerate a squalling child. He touched the handle of his blood-stained knife. If he cries, I will cut his throat.
Buffalo Caller shifted the boy to his left arm and drew his own knife. You will have to cut mine first.
It was unthinkable that one of the people might kill one another, but he would inflict grievous pain with the blade if Antelope made it necessary.
His companion backed off. Then do not let him cry.
This one is too brave to cry. Now let us go. We do not want to miss the big fight.
First I will burn the house.
Antelope's eyes pinched in warning.
If you are wise, you will kill that red-haired boy.
Buffalo Caller tightened his hold on the youngster.
Go on. Set your fire.
Buffalo Caller had seen white man towns before. He'd visited San Antonio in his early youth, riding boldly up and down its streets, challenging any and all to come out and fight him. It was a way of demonstrating his bravery to other young men in the event any might have doubted it. No townsman had accepted the challenge face to face, but Buffalo Caller proudly bore the scar of a bullet wound inflicted by some coward who hid inside a doorway to shoot him. When he painted himself for ceremony or battle, he always made a black circle around the scar so everyone would see and know that bullets did not easily kill him. For a fighter, scars were marks of honor. The column crossed a creek north of Victoria and paused while warriors took time to paint themselves and their mounts for battle. The paint carried strong medicine and helped ward off bullets. Buffalo Caller had turned his small captive over to the care of his younger wife, Whippoorwill. While women and children waited, the warriors split to make a circle around the town. Buffalo Caller saw no sign that the raiders' approach had aroused alarm. That surprised him. He could only surmise that the column had been mistaken for something other than what it was. It was known that members of the Lipan tribe sometimes visited the town for friendly barter, and Mexican horse traders came occasionally with large caballadas to barter or sell. A shout from one of the chiefs traveled quickly around the circle, picked up and relayed by other voices. The charge began with high-pitched yelling and a thunder of hoofbeats as warriors urged their horses into a run. Not until then did the town's citizens begin to realize they were under attack. The first resistance was a scattering of gunfire from buildings on the outskirts. That resistance soon mushroomed into desperate firing from the more central part of town. Warriors and horses began to falter and fall. Despite the Texans' slowness to recognize their danger, they put up a strong and costly defense. Buffalo Caller brought his horse to a quick stop after a bullet passed his ear, singing like a locust, then winding off the stone wall of a house. He saw his companions beginning to pull back. It seemed prudent to follow. Only someone who had yet to prove his valor or who valued glory above life would willingly plunge into a hailstorm of bullets fired by determined men hidden behind walls that arrows could not penetrate. He did not have to prove his courage anew. This was not a day he would choose to die. There was yet much he had not seen. Someone shouted that horses had been found just outside of town. Buffalo Caller withdrew from the siege. Though he had come for blood vengeance on the Americans, he would also be pleased to take their horses. He was amazed at the number. Mexicans had been loose herding several hundred on the prairie before recognizing their danger and fleeing into the protection of the town. Buffalo Caller guessed they had brought the horses to trade or sell. He would not have expected this welcome bonanza. With enthusiasm, he pitched into the rounding up of these horses and many others from nearby farms. By the time the gathering was done, the horse and mule herd had grown to tremendous proportions. Moving, it raised a towering cloud of dust, like an early spring windstorm out of the west. Even if the invaders were to turn back now, this had been a most profitable venture. Others in the band had killed several men unfortunate enough to fall into their path, and had stolen a white woman and her baby. After camping along a creek that night, they continued on their way, driving the great band of captured horses and mules. They came upon two men in a wagon, killing one, but somehow losing the other despite a diligent search. The white woman's baby began to cry, The impatient antelope wrested it from its mother's arms and impaled it on a spear. The baby quivered and died while the woman screamed. Buffalo Caller thought that a regrettable waste. The child might have grown up to be useful. He did not feel pity for mother or child, however. Both were Texan, and pity on an enemy was a dangerous indulgence for a warrior. An enemy spared was an enemy who might have to be faced again another day. Linville was a small but prosperous seaport, its several warehouses holding goods brought in by ship for wagon and cart transport to such inland towns as San Antonio and Nacogdoches. As had been the case at Victoria, the townspeople took little notice of the approaching warriors. Buffalo Caller guessed the huge horse and mule herd had misled them into assuming the visitors were traders like the Mexicans at Victoria, bringing animals to barter or sell. Citizens of the town began to shout and scream as he belatedly recognized the disaster thundering down upon them. They were too late to mount a defense the way those in Victoria had done. By dozens, they scrambled toward the shore. Men, women, and children ran in desperation. They piled into small boats tied to the wooden pier and frantically rowed away into the sea. Farther out, Buffalo Caller saw what appeared to be a large house floating, a curl of black smoke rising from its tall chimney. Beyond the steamship, he could see nothing but water and more water, endless to the horizon, reflecting the sunlight and burning his eyes. He stared in wonder. People had told him of such strange things, wooden houses that sat atop the water, but he had never quite believed them. He saw warriors kill a white man and drag two struggling women out of a boat, one white and one whose skin was black. They also captured a child. Antelope shouted, "Too many are getting away!" He forced his horse out into the surf, trying to catch one of the boats and its shrieking passengers. Buffalo Caller followed so far that the water rose up and soaked his moccasins, chilling his feet. He loosed a couple of arrows, but the boats bobbed like fallen leaves on the waves, and the stone-tipped shafts fell harmlessly into the gulf. He chose to waste no more, though Antelope kept trying. Buffalo Caller turned back, for the town lay open and defenseless, awaiting the raiders' pleasure. Several townspeople lay dead in the streets, caught and killed, before they could reach the boats. Buffalo Caller moved toward a large building a short distance from the docks. The Mexican guides had promised that the warehouses would be full of goods, wondrous beyond imagination. The people could take whatever they wanted and be welcome to it. There was no shame in stealing from Texans, the biggest thieves of all. Some of the boats went all the way out to the ship that lay offshore. Others stopped and simply floated along out of range, their passengers watching helplessly while the town fell to the invaders like wild plums dropping from a tree. Warriors who had followed them into the surf turned back to begin a joyous plundering of homes and warehouses. Buffalo Caller entered a store and marveled at the variety of treasures it offered. He had tasted apples in San Antonio, and he found a barrel full here. He bit eagerly into one while he searched the store for other delights. On the shelves, he found rolls of cloth, some plain, others in bright colors. Antelope joined him, shouting in glee as he yanked down a bolt of red material and began to unfold it, wrapping it around his shoulders and waist. He picked up a stovepipe hat and jammed it onto his head, bending the feather he wore tied into his braided black hair. Buffalo Caller thought Antelope looked ridiculous. He would not trade his buffalo headdress for all the hats in the store. But he carried out an armload of cloth he was sure would please his wives. A long string of red ribbon stretched behind him. He began smelling smoke. Other warriors were setting fire to houses as they finished their looting. The Comanches celebrated high carnival, sacking and burning while frustrated townspeople witnessed the destruction from sanctuary far out on the water. Late in the afternoon, wearying warriors began to draw away. They had packed many of the captured horses and mules with goods taken from Linville homes, stores, and warehouses. Buffalo Caller laughed at the sight of a mule with ribbons tied in its tail, kicking at a bolt of blue cloth that dragged in the dust behind. Many of the men wore white man clothes and hats of various descriptions. The wind tugged at several open umbrellas. Antelope had placed a hat on his horse's head after cutting slits so it would fit over the ears. It was proper that the horse wear a Texan hat, he said, for it had been taken from a Texan corral west of San Antonio. Hardly a building remained intact. Most, not already burned to the ground, were ablaze now as the raiders retreated.
A heavy pall of dark smoke hung over the town. Linville would be little but ashes and ruin when its citizens mustered courage to row back from the sea. Then they would know the true price of Texan treachery. It mattered not that the people here probably had nothing to do with what happened in the San Antonio Council House. They were white. In the eyes of the people, vengeance against one enemy was vengeance against all. They had no patience with individual responsibility. Separating the guilty from the innocent, all their enemies were guilty. Buffalo Caller noted that the head of the column was moving in a northwesterly direction. That pleased him. In a few days, he would be back in the familiar and pleasant surroundings of his own country. He had gazed upon the big water once, had felt its wetness and tasted its salt. His own eyes had witnessed a great house that floated upon the sea. He had not seen the fish as large as horses, but he had seen enough. His curiosity was satisfied. He thought of the boy he had taken and the pleasure his son would bring to his lodge, even one whose hair was red. It was time now to go home, to enjoy the fruits of conquest. It was time for dancing and celebration, for the proud telling of great and daring deeds. Chapter 2. Warren Webb enjoyed riding alongside Michael Shannon on the wagon road to Linville. The jovial farmer was pleasant company, never short of stories to tell. It mattered not whether they were totally true or were partly a construction of an imagination enriched by Shannon's 30 years or so of drifting from Tennessee across Arkansas and Louisiana and finally down the Texas coast. He had entered into every conflict he could reach, however far it might have been out of his way. Mike Shannon had never seen a fight he did not want to mix into, bringing all the gusto other men put into games and horse races. Though summer heat made each mile seem like two, conversation helped relieve the weight of fatigue. And if Shannon's speech easily lapsed into the profane, that too afforded its guilty pleasures. For Webb to use such language would be unseemly, if not actually forbidden by the scriptures. He was a circuit-riding minister whose small farm was sadly neglected because of the travel requirements of his higher calling. Coming from someone else, a little profanity offered a tantalizing hint of wickedness, a minor and harmless rebellion he found refreshing. Shannon seemed little inhibited by the fact that his riding companion was a man of the cloth who carried the word far past the forks of the creek where settlers could not afford to live their preacher. He said, "A God, Preacher Webb, this country's getting so choked up with people, they'll pretty soon be stumbling all over one another. I'm setting on moving west, out on the Colorado River. There's land to be had there, not half so dear as this on the coast." Shannon did not own the tract he plowed. He simply squatted on unclaimed land, using it until he tired of it or a rightful owner came along to take possession from him and his wife. In such a way had generations of poor farmers progressed slowly westward from the Alleghenies to the Ohio Valley and across the Mississippi into Texas, amassing little of the world's goods but incurring little in the way of debt and obligation. They could plant and harvest a crop, then leave when the spirit moved them or a real owner came along with the deed. Shannon had already done that more than once, though he was little, if any, older than Webb, and Webb would be 30 come October. For many, squatting was a means of survival in a country where cash was a stranger to most men's pockets. Now and then a farmer might roll up his sleeves and fight when someone came to move him, but most accepted their lot and looked to the west, confident that they would soon find a better place. It was a melancholy fact of life that trailblazers rarely profited like those who followed in their tracks. One sowed, another reaped. Webb would miss having Shannon around. "Surely you'd not depart our midst before you've harvested your crop, and leave the fruits of my labor for somebody who never broke a sweat? Old Mother Shannon never raised no half-wit sons, I God. I figure we'll leave in the fall and locate us a place. I'll break the land this winter and have it ready to seed in the spring." Webb understood the pioneer wanderlust, for he harbored a liberal case of it himself. It had caused him to leave his boyhood home in Alabama, and had brought him by fits and starts to the Republic of Texas after the revolution against Mexico. "I'd not mind following after you, Mike. I've an itch to be seeing new country.
Come with us, then. There's fever in this low ground, and I've noted that you've got an unhealthy cough. There's others moving out yonder. Where there's people, there's a need for somebody to teach the ways of the Lord, lest they go heathen.
Shannon was right. Webb's lungs sometimes ached, and often he felt himself short of strength. He was tall of frame, but so thin, he sometimes wondered how he managed to cast a decent shadow. He attributed his condition to the humidity and smothering heat of this region near the Gulf of Mexico. A higher elevation should be better for his health. Shannon said,
"It ain't good to stay one place too long. Dulls a man. You wear out one farm, you move on to another. That's what the Lord put the land here for."
I don't know that he meant for us to wear it out.
He must have, because he gave us so much. There ain't no end to it.
Shannon made a broad sweep with his arm toward a horizon flat and endless. For a while, Webb had been aware of a tan cloud hovering low in the northeast. He at first thought it might be a dust storm because the weather had turned dry of late. But it occurred to him that the wind did not seem strong enough to raise that much dust. Besides, the cloud appeared localized, moving slowly westward. Shannon thought along similar lines.
Kind of odd doings yonder, don't you think?
Webb had seen large horse herds stir dust like that. But this seemed an out-of-the-way place for traders to be taking a remuda away from the major settlements.
Might be a group of immigrants straight off of the main trail to look for grass. If so, maybe they're in the mood to hear the word, and might be me and you could get us a woman-cooked meal.
You had a woman-cooked breakfast this morning. Your Dora is as good a cook as ever I ate after. But I can't remember the last time I had a cup of real coffee that wasn't stretched out with parched grain. Maybe them folks have got some.
Webb had intended to be at the Linville settlement by dark, but he supposed tomorrow would be soon enough. If these people were in need of preaching, it was his obligation to offer it.
Let's go see about that coffee.
First sight of the horses aroused a strange sense of foreboding, a queasy feeling of finding himself in the wrong place.
Did you ever see so many in one bunch, Mike?
Shannon hauled up on the leather reins. Ordinarily given to shrugging off life's everyday aggravations with an easy, "Oh, what the hell," he appeared suddenly alarmed.
Something queer looking about this. They ain't no traitors, and they ain't no movers. What they are is Indians, ye got.
Webb could not believe this at first. The only Indians he had seen this near the coast had been small gatherings of Tonkawas, the poorest, raggedest people he had ever encountered, come to barter or beg. Folks said they could be ferocious as hungry wolves against their enemies, the Comanches, and that they even had cannibalistic tendencies. To him they had appeared harmless except for a little sticky-fingered thievery.
These were not Tonkawas.
Shannon said,
"I hope you have favor in the eyes of your maker. He better not let them see us before we get into that timber yonder."
Webb thought it prudent to be running while he consulted the Lord. He applied his spurs and drew his rifle from its long scabbard beneath his leg. It seemed impossible that they were not discovered, but the passing Indians gave no sign they had noticed.
Shannon said, "They think we're part of their bunch.
Our clothes and hats ought to tell them different." Shannon turned for another squint-eyed look.
"A lot of them are wearing hats, too. The store-bought kind, and I'd bet you a U.S. dollar they didn't buy them.
A few wore coats as well, despite the summer heat. A couple had them on backward, buttons in the rear. Many horses and mules were laden with blankets and bolts of cloth. Trophies of war, proudly displayed."
Shannon tried to make a rough count, but gave it up. "Looks to me like there's a couple thousand horses and mules, and maybe 1,000 Indians. Odd thing is, they've got squaws and children with them.
But who are they? Where'd they come from?"
"Comanches, and I'd guess they're fresh from looting the hell out of some place. Heading back to their own country now, most likely.
God pity any poor souls they happen upon along their way." Shannon frowned, mulling on that thought.
"There's some farms out yonder, the direction they're traveling. They'll gobble up them folks like wolves gobble a rabbit.
We could circle around ahead of them and give warning. How's your faith?"
"Strong enough, long as I'm riding with the preacher. The Lord ain't gonna let nothing happen to you."
The column inched along, the animals traveling in a walk.
Webb could see women and children. Were it not for the evidence of loot being carried away, he might take this for a tribe peacefully moving from one hunting ground to another. He saw no outriders. Thought it stood to reason there must be some somewhere. They don't seem to be in a hurry or worried about anybody jumping them. Shannon said, I'd feel safe too if I was them. It'd take an army to jump a bunch the size of that. Riding at an angle away from the Indian column, the two remained within the cover of the timber to its southern edge. Webb looked back. We ought to be far enough now. He set his horse into a long trot, paralleling the Comanches. Shannon spurred alongside him, glancing warily in one direction then the other. They didn't pick all them doodads and all them horses and mules off of the trees. I'd wager they've left a string of dead folks behind them. First, we need to look after the ones still alive. I'll pray for the others when I have the time. At the first farm, they found a man and his wife working in a garden just south of a log cabin. The farmer listened to their report with suspicion.
A bunch of Indians that size don't seem likely. You sure you didn't just see them in a bottle?
The farmer's wife seemed to believe right off. She brought her hands to her mouth to stifle a cry. Shannon was not inclined toward patience when calamity bore down.
I've been known to sip a little whiskey now and again, but Brother Webb don't drink, nor is he given a lion. Take a look at that dust coming yonder. It ain't no sea breeze, I got.
The urgency in Shannon's voice began to temper the farmer's skepticism.
But Comanches, it's close to the coast. Must be a bunch of Tonks, or maybe Karankawas. There ain't that many Karankawas in the whole nation. Wouldn't make no difference anyway. One'll kill you as dead as the other. You've got to get out of here.
The farmer at last believed, and with belief he reached a state bordering on panic.
Martha, get the young'uns ready. I'll hitch up the team.
The woman rushed screaming into the cabin. Webb and Shannon helped the farmer harness his mules and saddle his horse. Webb boosted the woman up onto the seat while Shannon lifted three frightened children into the bed of the wagon. The farmer pointed.
You'll find the Johnson family over that away where you see that stand of trees. Old man Blessing and his boys are a mile or so further on. They're the last ones I know of in that direction.
He put his horse into a run, trying to catch up to the fast-moving wagon. The woman was applying the whip, and the children clung desperately to the wagon sideboards to keep from being bounced out. The Johnsons required no persuasion. Webb had known the young family at camp meeting, and they accepted his word. Their only question was which direction they should run. They wasted little time gathering up a few possessions and quitting their place. Shannon watched them with regret.
Ain't apt to be much left here when they come back.
There'll be the land.
Abner Blessing was a towering, raw-boned farmer whose broad shoulders appeared to sag under their own weight. Webb had once heard him declare that he had fit engines all over hell in half of Georgia before coming to Texas. He was ready to take these on. The Blessings had built their cabin of stone, befitting a family of great strength. He pointed to his three grown sons, all rough-cut out of raw oak in his image.
Me and my boys ain't giving up our place. We'll take our stand behind them stone walls.
Webb argued, you'd just as well try to wipe out a hornet's nest with a sharp stick.
I don't doubt your fighting spirit, Mr. Blessing, but you know what happened at the Alamo. Them fellers killed a heap of Mexicans, but they lost the battle. Me and the boys, we've worked hard to build what we've got here.
Reluctantly, Blessing turned to his sons.
Tom, Bert, Jim, go gather the horses and mules. Them varmints may burn the house, but be damned if they'll add our stock to their string.
The young men hastened to comply. Shannon moved to help them.
Blessing said, I hate to leave here without a fight. Where you reckon the Red Devils have been?
Webb could only shrug. They were coming from the direction of Linville when we saw them.
Linville?
The farmer clenched his fists, his knuckles bulging like pine knots.
I've got a sister there, and her family. You don't reckon?
I don't know.
Misery came into the man's blue eyes, followed by a building anger.
Everybody can't just up and run. There's bound to be somebody with the guts to stand and fight.
Maybe, if the Comanches didn't leave everybody dead behind them.
Maybe me and the boys can put some fighting men together. There's four of us to start. Six, Mike and me, we'll go with you.
Webb looked to Shannon for silent confirmation. They struck southward, driving the family's extra horses and mules several miles before they came upon a brush-lined creek. Blessing told his sons,
Scatter the stock down in there. I doubt the Redskins will come this far off of their line of march.
That done, he said, Let's be heading for Linville.
They led off without waiting for argument. Webb offered none, and Shannon seemed as eager as Blessing for a fight. They pushed their horses into a lope for short distances, then slowed to a trot to conserve the mount's strength. Webb could see the cloud of dust to the north, marking the location of the Comanche column. The oldest of the Blessing boys, Tom, drew up on the reins. "Listen, I think I hear shooting." Webb first thought the Indians might have caught one of the families he and Shannon had warned, but he decided that was not the case. The sound indicated many guns. The elder Blessing said, "Somebody's done lit into them. Come on, boys, or we're liable to miss the fight." He spurred off toward the dust. His sons struggled to catch up. Webb gave Shannon a questioning glance. Shannon said, "Hell, preacher, who wants to live to get old and decrepit?" They never managed to close the distance between themselves and the Blessings, but presently, through the dust, they could see a back-and-forth surging of men and horses. Rifles and pistols snapped in a desultory manner. Webb reined up, for he wanted to grasp the full situation before riding into the middle of it. He saw a large company of white men dismounted, shooting at horseback Indians who circled them. Farther ahead, the main column of Comanches hurried away with their women and children, their horse and mule herd, while this detached set of warriors fought a delaying action. Blessing and his sons had halted, watching the fight from 200 yards. Uncertainty held the big farmer back, though he chafed to ride headlong into the scrap. "We'd probably all get killed if he was to try to break through. Maybe we can do them fellers more good from out here." Shannon said, "At least, I God, we can give them devils something else to be worrying about." The men dismounted. Webb tied a knot in the end of his split leather reins and slipped them over his arm so the horse could not easily jerk away. He dropped to one knee and aimed his rifle as he heard shots fired on either side of him. After the flash, a white cloud of smoke blossomed around the barrel. He could not see if he had hit anything. Some of the Indians immediately split off and charged toward the six men. Anticipating this, two of the Blessing boys had held their fire. While four reloaded, the pair took their time in firing. A horse went down, and the charge broke up. The Indians zigzagged in a rough circle, reconsidering. By the time they decided to rush again, the reloaded guns blazed a second volley. One of the Indians fell from his horse. The others halted, two grabbing him up between them, carrying him back toward the main group. Soon, the larger column had moved well beyond the skirmish. The nearby Indians broke their circle and began to travel slowly in a westerly direction. Those who had firearms kept shooting back in the direction of their adversaries. The company of white men continued firing toward them. The range became too great for accuracy by either side. Shannon said, "Looks like they've had enough entertainment for a while. Let's go see how the boys yonder made out." A rough count told Webb that the company was made up of more than 100 men. Most had managed to hang on to their horses through the fight, though a few animals were wounded and at least a couple lay dead. A horseman rode out to meet the six incoming riders. "Welcome, men. You almost missed the skirmish." Webb thought he knew the face. "Seems to me I've seen you at camp meeting." The man nodded. "You're a preacher, as I recollect. We're volunteers out of Victoria. We followed this bunch all the way from Linville." Blessing pressed. "Linville? What happened there?" "They took the town by surprise, killed several folks, burned down just about everything. Ain't much left but ashes." Blessing swore, mostly under his breath. "I have a sister in Linville. Most of the people got away in boats. Like as not, she did too. The dead were mostly men folks, I think. They tarried too long fighting a losing battle." Blessing swallowed and looked at his sons, then back to the man from Victoria. "You all ain't giving up the fight, are you?" "We haven't even started yet. We'll nip at their rear till more outfits catch up to us." Webb said, "There's more on the way?" "The alarm's been sent out in all directions. There'll be some ranging companies along, I expect." Several Victoria men stood in a circle, heads bowed, staring down at a man on the ground. It was evident that he was dead. Shannon said, "Since we've got a preacher with us, I expect y'all would like some words spoke." One of the bystanders said, "We'd appreciate it mightily." Webb removed his hat and the others followed suit. He said a brief prayer for the stranger who lay before him. One of the Victoria men said, "Pray that before we get through, we send most of them bloody-handed Comanches after him." Webb doubted the propriety of such a prayer, but at the moment, standing in the presence of death, he could think of no reply. Most of the Victoria men took solace in the fact that they appeared to have killed or wounded several Indians. It crossed Webb's mind that he might pray for those too, but he dismissed the thought. The devil had sent them. The devil could have them. The captain of the volunteers came forward.
I'd be pleased to have you men join us if you have no company of your own. Blessing was torn. I ought to be seen about my sister. His son Tom placed a large hand on his father's shoulder. You go find Aunt Bess. Me and Bert and Jim will do the family share of the fighting. The two brothers signaled agreement. Blessing cleared his throat and shook hands with his sons, each in turn. I've always been proud of you boys. A man couldn't have asked for better. Shortly he rode away toward whatever was left of Linville. Tom Blessing told the captain of the volunteers, "We got cousins in Gonzales. They'd be mighty put out if they was to miss the main fight. Reckon we've got time to go and fetch them? You might run into Indians along the way. It'll be their own fault if they mess with us Blessings." The captain glanced toward the dust left by the departing Comanches. "Till the ranger companies show up, there aren't enough of us here to do more than pester their rear guard a little. If you can gather up some more help, go with my Blessings." Shannon said, "Me and the preacher will go with you, Tom, just in case you do run into some Indians." He glanced at Webb. "All right, preacher. You said it yourself. Who wants to get old and decrepit?"
Chapter 3. Riding at the rear of the long column, Buffalo Caller looked back toward the white men who trailed behind like wolves following a buffalo herd. Their pursuit had become something of a game, parry and thrust, feint and retreat, in an effort to draw warriors into a trap. After a couple of these episodes resulted in a few casualties, the Comanches had become slow about rising to the bait. Buffalo Caller saw no reason such a superior force should play the white man's game. The people had all the advantage. It appeared to him that the whites were trying to delay the Indian retreat by pecking at its edges. They probably hoped for reinforcements. He doubted that they could muster enough fighting men to mount any serious challenge against a force this strong. Should they try, it would only mean more scalps dangling from war lances, more celebration when the people were back on their home ground. Buffalo Caller would welcome a stiff fight. Linville had been so easy he almost felt cheated. Swift as the antelope kept looking back, sweat running from beneath the band of the white man's stovepipe hat he had worn since they had sacked the coastal town. Because of the heat, he no longer wore red cloth wrapped around his body, but he had not abandoned it. He had it loosely rolled and tied behind his rawhide-covered saddle. It was for his wife, he claimed. Antelope was impatient, as usual. "We should strike them like the lightning. We could kill them all before they have time to catch a breath." They had tried that already, though with only a small portion of their fighting force, expecting the Texans to flee in terror. Instead, the hair faces had surprised them with a stiff resistance. Several warriors had had to be carried away after the skirmish. "There is time enough," Buffalo Caller said. "Let them become tired and hungry. Sooner or later they will begin to straggle. Then we can cut them to pieces. But they are growing stronger. More tables keep joining them. All the more of them to die." He had noticed small groups joining the pursuers periodically, but the Texans remained relatively small in number. Buffalo Caller was confident that they were much too weak to make any meaningful dent in the Comanche column, strung out so far now that he could not see the head of it. If the enemy should have the poor judgment to try, their blood and bones would enrich this prairie ground, and the grass would grow stronger for years. Antelope opened his hands, showing all his fingers. "With this many men, I could run them all the way back to the water." He had always been prone to overstate his accomplishments, and sometimes took personal credit for deeds performed by others, as long as he did not expect to be challenged by someone who had been there. "Go then. I will marry your widow, and give her many sons." "You have two wives already, and your seed produces only girls. You have no son except that Texan boy." Buffalo Caller saw danger in Antelope's eyes. Antelope had repeatedly made veiled threats against the child since they had taken him from his dead mother's side. "The boy is not your concern." "I tell you again, that hair is an ill omen. It looks like blood. I had a dream last night. The boy will bring evil. If you do not have the stomach to do what must be done, let me." He clasped the deer horn handle of his knife. Buffalo Caller stiffened. "You will not touch him." Antelope roughly pulled his horse away and joined other warriors, but a dark scowl said the question was not settled. Buffalo Caller knew their friendship, though of long standing, would not be enough to protect the boy. Antelope believed strongly in medicine and omens. He had a remarkable ability to sense the presence of dark spirits when no one else was aware of them. Buffalo Caller believed in medicine as strongly as anyone, but his guardian spirits often disagreed with Antelope's. Antelope claimed to carry the power of the badger, and certainly he possessed that animal's belligerent temperament. Still, Buffalo Caller sometimes wondered if Antelope was not misled by Coyote the trickster. Coyote was always up to mischief. He liked to play with men's minds and lead them into folly. Antelope's implied threat began to play upon the mind of Buffalo Caller. To reassure himself that the boy was all right, he put his mount into a long trot, passing the rear guard and going around the massive herd of stolen horses and mules. The women and children rode near the head of the column, where they were considered safest from attack by the trailing Texans. He sought out Whippoorwill, the younger and prettier of his two wives, the one he had chosen to accompany him on this long journey. She carried the boy in front of her on a high-stepping sorrel mare taken from the Mexican traders at Victoria. "Is he all right?" he asked, though he could see no evidence to the contrary. The boy still wore his homespun clothes, now dirty and beginning to ravel from the stresses of traveling. He did not look Comanche, but the shirt and trousers would have to last until the band made its way back to the homeland. Then he could be put into something more suitable.
"He does not understand anything I tell him," Whippoorwill said. "At times he talks, but they are not words I know."
"He will learn soon enough to speak like a Comanche. Has Antelope said anything to you about him?"
"This morning, as we broke camp, he said the spirits came to him in a dream and told him we should kill the red hair before he brings death to us."
"Watch out for him. Do not let him get close to the boy."
"What if he is right? What if the red hair is bad medicine?"
"My spirits have told me no such thing. Antelope makes wind and thinks it is spirits speaking to him."
Satisfied for the time being, he dismounted and let his horse graze the dry grass while he waited for the column to pass. Its movement was slow as a turtle's, he thought. He remembered his doubts when the council first decided to allow women and children to accompany this grand punitive excursion. Ordinarily, it would be considered too dangerous, but so many warriors had massed together that the expedition seemed secure enough to allow such luxury. It was argued that the outnumbered whites would fall like dry leaves in an autumn wind. Though resistance had proven strong enough to turn the raiders back from the heart of Victoria, Linville had been crushed like a beetle beneath a warrior's moccasin. The spoils had been extraordinary. Those who had chosen to remain behind in the homeland would soon be ashamed for their timidity. The rear guard came along after a time, and Buffalo Caller grasped his horse's mane, pulling himself up. His eyes met those of Antelope for a moment before Antelope looked away. What he saw there convinced him that once they reached home, he would have to remove his family from Antelope's reach. A warrior known as feared by his enemies pulled up beside him.
"More white men have joined their brothers back there."
He pointed his chin toward the horseman, who trailed at a respectful distance.
The number had increased, that was evident. "There are still far more of us than of them."
Feared by his enemies held up three fingers.
"It has been 3 days, and they have not given up."
"They will, or we will destroy them when we get back into our own country."
Before camping that night, Buffalo Caller noted where Antelope located himself and found a place far away for Whippoorwill and the red-haired boy. The next morning was the fourth since they had chased the boats into the big water. The column had been traveling on gradually rising ground. The air was drier and less oppressive than at the coast, though the summer sun began spreading its heat soon after its rising. He could not yet see them, but Buffalo Caller could visualize the limestone hills not far ahead. Soon, the people would be back in their own environment. The raid had been more than satisfactory, especially in terms of the wealth they had taken, but it would be good to breathe the familiar air of home. The unexpected approach of four Texan horsemen seemed more an affront than a threat. Surely they would turn back when they saw the full strength of the Comanche force. But they did not. Antelope gave a shout and led several rearguard warriors in a charge. One of the Texans fired, and a warrior fell. The charge broke up in the face of unexpectedly fierce gunfire. The warriors turned back, rejoining the rest of the rearguard. The Texans kept coming. From a flank, a second group of Texans broke out of a fringe of live oak timber and quickly halted, seeming surprised by the number of Indians they faced. They turned back into the trees.
This time Buffalo Caller joined other warriors in pursuit. Yelling for blood, they charged into the timber. The Texans retreated, though one somehow lost his horse and ran after his companions afoot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.